25 आवर्स ऑफ रेडियो बायोलॉजी. दीज आर द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ रेडिएशन इफेक्ट्स और द बेसिस ऑफ रेडिएशन इफेक्ट्स और द इफेक्ट्स दैट वी सी बिकॉज ऑफ रेडिएशन रिपेयर रीडिस्ट्रीब्यूशन रीपॉपुलेशन रीऑक्सीजनेशन एंड रेडियोसेंसिटिविटी. ओके so to cut long story short, tumor cells normal tissue, okay, because of repair tumor cells it is a detrimental or a negative impact or it, if you have to say it will decrease therapeutic ratio, but because of normal tissues it will increase therapeutic ratio. Since repair is greater in normal tissues, it results in higher therapeutic ratio. This principle. Redistribution increases radiosensitivity, it increases cell kill. Okay, so like this, all these phenomena have an impact on tumor cells, also on normal tissues. And the combination of all this will have an impact on therapeutic ratio. Okay. Now we are going to study in detail each of these phenomena. So 5 hours of radiobiology. By Dr. Archer, he was my senior, amazing guy, amazing presentations. If you come across his presentations, do go through them. Okay. Radiobiology is a branch of science which combines the basic principles of physics and biology and is concerned with the action of ionizing radiation on biological tissues and living organisms. History of fractionation. So as in our previous lecture series, we came across this figure where the principle was that they wanted to sterilize this animal without burning the scrotum. So they found that if instead of giving a single fraction, if they fractionated it, then the scrotum was spared. This was the first basis of fractionation. So biological basis of altered fractionation was given by first H. Rodney Withers. Conventional is commonly not universally correct, and so with dose fractionation in radiotherapy. So, on the basis of this principle, that the conventional is 2 gray 5 times per week, maybe a reasonable average treatment, one should always focus for. Okay. So how ionizing radiation acts, it's either directly ionizing or indirectly ionizing. Directly ionizing, provided the individual particles having sufficient kinetic energy, they can disrupt the atomic structure of the absorber through which they pass directly and produce chemical and biological changes. And indirectly ionizing do not produce chemical and biological damage themselves, but when they are absorbed in the material through which they pass, they give up their energy to produce fast moving charged particles that in turn are able to produce damage. So if you see the direct effect, it is directly this photon damaging the DNA, and indirect produces via radicals. So time scale of events for ionization of atoms resulting in free radical formation is 10 raised to minus 16 to 10 raised to minus 12 seconds. The free radicals formed in biomolecules resulting in DNA damage, 10 raised to minus 12 to 10 raised to minus 2 seconds. 1 second to several hours, DNA damage resulting in unrepaired or misrejoined DNA damage or irreparable DNA damage. And irreparable DNA damage resulting in further biological effects such as cell death, apoptosis, mutagenesis. It takes us 2 years. A very important table from exam point of view. So this is the figure showing the linear quadratic component, that if the event was only directly ionizing, then the absorptions per cell of the damage would have been linear. But the damage is either direct or indirect when it happens with the help of via radicals. So when it is indirect, it is proportional to the square of the dose, as was discussed last time, resulting in this kind of a plot. So it is a combination of direct plus indirect. So now coming to the first R, that is repair. Types of repair. So there are different, depending upon the damage, there are different types of repairs. So DNA damage, either it can be a single stranded damage, a single break or a double break. So single strand repair mechanisms, which include methyl transferase, base excision repair, nucleotide excision repair, mismatch repair. Double strand repair mechanisms are non-homologous end joining and homologous recombination repair. So lethal, irreversible, irreparable leads to cell death. Potentially lethal damage can be modified by the post-irradiation environment. Sublethal damage, repaired in hours, if a second dose is given, can interact with more damage to create lethal damage, represents shoulder on cell survival curve. Sublethal damage repair increases survival when a dose is fractionated over time. Potentially lethal damage, first described by Phillips and Tolmach in 1966, by definition, a spectrum of radiation damage that may or may not result in cell lethality depending upon the cell's post-irradiation conditions. Suboptimum conditions, overcrowded conditions, reduced temperature, metabolite inhibitors, balanced salt solutions. Clinical significance of PLD, Wischelbaum and Little et al. Potentially lethal damage repair after a single dose varies considerably from one cell line. It correlates with clinical radiocurability. Less curable tumors show the greatest degree of potentially lethal damage recovery. However, to date, these parameters have not been confirmed in larger clinical experiences to justify their use as predictors of radiotherapy outcomes. ओके वन सेक, लेट मी जस्ट सी. There are three types of damage. One is lethal damage, potentially lethal damage, and sublethal damage. Lethal, the word lethal means dead. There is no other meaning. So if there is a term saying lethal, it means dead. Okay. Potentially lethal damage means it is otherwise dead, means the damage has the potential to kill if something is not done about it. Like, for example, if I give you an analogy, you have a heart attack. A heart attack is supposed to cause damage. But if within the window period, if you are reaching the hospital, getting an angiography done, getting a stent or a bypass done, so if a stenting is done, and you are getting a full recovery, the potentially lethal damage has been converted into no damage. Means, so if post irradiation conditions are modified, BLD can be prevent. So what are the post irradiation conditions or suboptimal conditions for the PLD to be converted into a LD? Overcrowded, low temperature, balanced salt solutions, and what's the other one? Metabolite inhibitors. So, for example, if already we know that radiation causes effects through direct and indirect effect. Now, if you already radicals are present, how overcrowding will convert PLD into its otherwise? It's not, it will convert PLD into LD. It will rather prevent conversion of PLD into LD. By overcrowding means when the photon is going through, if some of the cells are missed, then there may not be a damage in that cell. Okay. Because for a good tumor control, you need each and every cell to die. Even if a single cell is missed, that can result in the failure of treatment. And that's why if there is overcrowding, especially because all these damages are studied in laboratory in petri dishes. Okay. There, if the cells are in clumps, and when you are studying radiation effects, you may not be able to see the radiation effects in each and every cell, and you may not be able to appreciate the PLD. And that is the reason why overcrowding is mentioned, because clinically, overcrowding may not be that, what you call it, important or relevant. But in laboratories where you are studying each cells and colonies at an individual level, if they are clumped, if the cells are clumped and you are studying radiation, you may miss out on the cells. Okay, and that is why that is a suboptimal condition for studying the PLD. Okay. And regarding low temperature, if the metabol, when does cells die? when DNA damage happens, and then that when DNA or the cell tries to replicate, at that time the cell death happens, called as mitotic cell death. So if the cell is not multiplying, that DNA damage may not, and the cell may live with that DNA damage. And so any condition that is inhibiting mitosis, or any condition that is inhibiting the metabolism of the cells, keeping the cells cellular metabolism at a very low level, the cell may be able to survive, and that's why may not die. Okay. So the clinical significance of these are the cells which are responsible for potential lethal damage. Okay, now coming to sublethal damage repair. Sublethal damage repair proposed by Elkin and Sutton hits or damages that were registered as part of accumulation process yet did not in an end of themselves produce cell killing, whereby definition sublethal means they are not at all lethal. Sublethal, like they are not optimum, suboptimum. So sublethal damage only become lethal when it interacted with additional sublethal damage. Okay, like to give an analogy of lethal, potential lethal and sublethal, imagine stabbing a person. If you stab a person directly into the carotids, okay, the person will die, lethal damage, or directly into the heart, the person will die, lethal damage. But if you stab a person in the liver, okay, person will die, but if reached to the hospital, may survive. But if you stab a person in the abdomen elsewhere, okay, person may not die. But you have to stab again and again at multiple points, so that finally stabbing will become lethal. Okay. Okay, and this sublethal damage is response repair. Sublethal damage is responsible for the shoulder. For this reason, the shoulder, you can see on the cell survival curves. So after this, we'll be taking cell survival curves. So the shoulder is because of the repair. Okay. Okay, repair half time for normal tissue endpoint. Average repair half time for early responding tissue is 3 hours. So at 6 hours duration, 75% repairs have happened. Okay. Why this is important? This is important to know, because between two fractionations, if you want to give a radiation dose again, suppose if a patient says that tomorrow, you want to give two fractions today. So how you will decide after how much time can you give it? Radiobiologically, it should be acceptable. Then you should have a gap of at least 6 hours, so that the early responding tissues, they have multiplied. See, skin has around 0.35 to 1 hour. For mucositis, 2 to 4 hours. Radiation myelopathy, more than 5 hours. Skin telangiectasia. So all these features, T half for repair is this many hours. So at least two T halves should be gone in order to have expected good repair. Okay, depends upon radiation quality. Less for radiations of increasing LET and the oxygenation status of the cells. Okay, सब लीथल डैमेज रिकवरी इज लार्जली रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर डोज रेट इफेक्ट फॉर लो एलईडी रेडिएशन. ओके सी इफ द डोज रेट इफ यू इंक्रीज द डो रिड्यूस द डोज रेट ओके यू आर गिविंग मोर टाइम फॉर रिपेयर. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फिगर कंप्राइजिंग ऑल द आवर्स and the showing the effect on the cell survival curve. Okay, this is the most sensitive cell survival curve, this is the most resistant cell survival curve. If you see, because of repair the cell survival curve shifts to the right, because of redistribution the cell survival curve is shifting to the left, because of proliferation or repopulation it is shifting again to the right. Okay, so this is a very important figure. Now, acute versus late responding tissues. All three generic types of repair sub lethal injury. Greater sparing of late tissues. Consistency with which the total dose necessary for each given late effect increases more rapidly when dose per fraction is decreased. A dose per fraction has decreased, higher doses tolerated by late tissues. Preferential sparing of at doses of at less than 2 gray. So this figure we had seen in last session also, the ISO effect curves, that at dose per fractions how late tissues are more responding. Clinical importance, increased normal tissue tolerance versus decreased tumor control. Small differences in recovery capacity between normal and tumor cells after one dose are magnified into large differences after 30 or more doses. Reduced repair capacity due to hypoxia and decreased CAMP in tumor cells. Any issues with repair? So repair is important from normal tissues from the point of view of reduction of side effects, and it is detrimental from the point of view of tumor control. But there is a preferential greater repair in normal tissues because in tumor control, tumor cells already the repair mechanisms are effect faulty. Okay. And repair is one of the reasons why tumor cells are resistant. Okay, any issues? So let us go to the next R, repopulation. Okay, first initiated by Fowler et al. As an attempt to explain the dose rate effect along with the SLDR. Increase in surviving fraction of irradiated cells resulting from cell division is called as repopulation. Two important aspects. When does it start and rate of repopulation in different tissue? Measured by split dose technique, increase in number of cells after first dose is reflected by increase in size of second dose required to produce certain constant level of effect, ISO effect. Fowler's experiment, same number of fractions, 5 days versus 28 days. Repopulation, same overall treatment time, 5 fraction versus 21 fractions, 13 gray. The change in fraction number was more important than change in the overall treatment time. Did you understand this, or do you want me to explain this in detail? See, there are two components. See, there are two components in radiation treatment. One is overall treatment time and the other is fractions. Okay. So, and the two components which are detrimental, repopulation and repair. Okay. If you increase see, if you keep the number of fractions same, okay, and overall treatment time is changed, sorry, if you increase the overall treatment time beyond the certain time, then you have to increase the dose to compensate for repopulation. But and if you here, if you increase the number of fractions or decrease or change, keeping overall treatment time same, you have to compensate for repair. Okay, so repopulation compensation is roughly usually around 1.5, means that as a gray, this is roughly per day, amounts to 6 additional 6.8, means in the range of 1 between 0.8 to 1.5, roughly amounts to 6 gray. But for repair, if you have to compensate for radiation, it comes to around 13 gray. In Fowler's experiment, it was 13 gray for repair and 6 gray for overall treatment time or for repopulation. So coming from this, what is more damaging, repopulation or repair?
Repair.
Yes, repair is more damaging. So one, that is why if your overall treatment time is increasing, it's okay. But number of fractions should be constant as much as possible. Okay. So the change in fraction number was more important than change in overall treatment time. In acute responding tissues, the onset of repopulation is early because cell cycle is rapid. In the jejunal mucosa, the lag time before the onset of radiation-induced proliferation may be less than 24 hours. In the colon and stomach, it is slightly longer. In contrast, in renal tubules, there is no histological evidence of cell depletion for many months after irradiation, and there is a long lag period before the onset of repopulation. In the mouse, it takes more than 12 months to reconstitute a tubule. So, depends upon normal turnover kinetics of the tissue to the dose the tissue is exposed and the latency present. Once, see, if the latency is greater, the latent greater than the entire treatment duration, then it is the late tissue and usually the repair has already begun in that tissue and the effects are not seen if the dose per fraction is less. Once begins, quickly reaches a maximum rate. In experimental animals, starts by 24 to 48 hours. In mice, some approximate doubling times for clonogenic cells is 8 hours, colon 12 hours. In humans, tissue turnover kinetics are slower than in mice. High initial doses may shorten the lag period, but only by 1 or 2 days. In general, the lag period is shorter for chemotherapy, hypothermia, and surgery, because the cell depletion that stimulates regeneration occurs more rapidly than after radiation. If daily radiation is suspended, example during a 10 to 14 day break in a split course accelerated regimen, क्लोनोजेनिक सेल्स में रिपॉपुलेट एट 2 to 3 times दिस रेट. ह्यूमन टिश्यूज, सो टू नर्चर ह्यूमन टिश्यूज रिस्पॉन्ड मोर स्लोली. इंटेस्टिनल म्यूकोसा बिगिन्स टू रीजेनरेट विद इन 24 to 48 hours. स्किन्स आर स्लोअर टू रिस्पॉन्ड. बोन मैरो क्विकली एज इन म्यूकोसा, ऑल्दो द पैटर्न्स ऑफ डिफरेंशिएशन वेरीज विद टाइम. ओरल म्यूकोसा स्टार्ट्स बाय 10 to 12 days. स्पर्मेटोगोनियम एक्सेप्शन, ऑल्दो हाई टर्न ओवर रेट एक्सिबिट स्लो एंड इनकम्प्लीट रीजेनरेटिव रिस्पॉन्स. See, these response rates will give you an idea how your acute reactions are going to behave. See this here. If you see oral mucosa starts by 10 to 12 days. So once your radiation is complete from the last day, you call your patients at 2 weeks for clinical assessment. This is because your oral mucosa starts healing by 10 to 12 days. No point in calling early. Unless you need to provide very high supportive care, but expect healing in 2 weeks. Okay, skin may take 3 weeks. Intestinal mucosa 1 to 2 days. So if there are patient who has post radiation, they are complaining of lot of loose motions. So you, how much you should say that it will take 2 to 3 days for it to subside. So don't worry. Okay. And even bone marrow, just like mucosa. So if in bone marrow, if you see the counts are low, no need to call the next day. You can give filgrastim or you can observe depending upon the counts. And then over next 3 days, ask the patient to come after 3 days. Don't call every day. Else, if the counts are very low and you think that the patient requires hospitalization, that's a different story. So this is a busy looking plot showing telling the same thing. Okay, now what we studied was repopulation in normal tissues. Now what happens in tumors? Capacity to accelerate growth rate as a result of the cytosidal effects of RT and receptor upregulation. Onset of regeneration is slower after multiple fractions compared to a large single dose of radiation. Regeneration is slower than acutely responding tissues. The total dose needs to be increased when overall treatment time exceeds 4 to 5 weeks. And that is the reason why we should finish the treatment in less than 4 to 5 weeks. Okay. So estimated cell cycle kinetic parameters. So I'm not going to into the detail of this table. I'm just pausing at it for a few seconds. If you want to just see and any term you want me to explain. The most important here is potential doubling time. If you see teapot, potential doubling time for the cells is around 2 to 19 or 5 days. And usual tumor cell cycle time is around 6.5 to 6.5 days. And the another term that is important from clinical point of view is volume doubling time. Direct measurement of tumor dimensions over time. It is 5 to 650 days. Okay, on an average 90 days, that is 3 months. So if you want to explain to a patient, explain this, that within 3 months it doubles. And that is why it is very important that we have a regular 3 monthly follow-up. That if by chance, if you have missed out on a small and it has not doubled within 3 months or increased in size within 3 months, most unlikely it is to be a tumor. That is the reason we say close follow-up. That means every 3 monthly we have to see it. Okay. So these are for different sites, the volume doubling time. See, for prostate, the volume doubling time is 1100 days. Head neck, 45 days. Breast, 82 days. Lung, 46. So again different. This is another table, an important table. Overall time, acute reactions determined primarily by rate of dose accumulation. Example, weekly dose rate. Due to disbalance between rate of cell killing by radiation and cell regeneration from surviving stem cells. Time taken to heal depends upon the total dose, determines number of surviving clonogenic cells, provided weekly dose rate exceeds the regenerative capacity of surviving stem cells. Late reactions, little or no difference on overall treatment time. Okay. So when radiation is protracted over several weeks, regeneration of surviving stem cells during course of treatment is the most potent phenomenon, contributing to differential sparing on normal tissues and tumors. But growth of small proportion of tumors, example Burkitt's lymphoma, may outstrip regeneration of some early normal tissue. Repopulation can increase the tolerance of the mucosa to a conventional dose regimen by an average of at least 1 gray per day, which is equivalent to approximately a doubling of clonogenic cells numbers every 2 days. Each doubling time in tumor clonogen number adds 2 to 4 gray to the dose for tumor control. In hypothetical model, dose of radiation needs to be increased by 60 centigray for everyday interruption of treatment. Hematopoietic growth factors such as GCSF, GMCF, erythropoietin, and interleukin-11 can accelerate proliferation of hematopoietic cells. In epithelial tissues, keratinocyte growth factor, which is specific for epithelial cells, has similar potential. Okay. So, to cut long story short, repopulation or oblique regeneration is important for healing and having reduced side effects. At the same time, it is detrimental from tumor control point of view. However, for tumor control, the regeneration is slower as compared to normal tissues, and it takes a certain time, usually around 4 to 5 weeks. So it is always better to finish off your treatment within 4 to 5 weeks. And if it is exceeding that, better to compensate it by increasing the dose. And in normal tissues, every tissue has a differential repopulation or regeneration schedule. Based on that, the side effect profile varies. Redistribution. Okay. Now coming to, what's the time? Redistribution. So different phases of cell cycle we know which are the radio resistant and radio sensitive phases. Now each of the cells, they keep moving from G1 to S, S to G2, G2 to M. They keep moving in these phases. So when they keep moving in these phases of cell cycle, okay, so some cells are in radiosensitive phases, some cells are in radioresistant phases. So obviously, as we all know, S is the most radioresistant phase and G2M is the most radiosensitive phase. So what happens when we are giving first fraction, the radiosensitive phases are killed, the radioresistant phases are spared. Now, after some time, on next day when we give the radiation, the radioresistant phases move towards radiosensitive phases. So on and so forth. And then the ones which were radioresistant now are now radiosensitive today. Hello? So the concept of different phases of cell cycle was introduced by Howard and Pelk in 1953. After a dose of irradiation, there is a progression of cells through the cell cycle during interval between split doses. This is termed as reassortment. length of time in phases is total cell cycle 11 hours for CHO and HeLa cells. I think these are hamster ovary cells. Yeah, chicken hamster ovary cells and HeLa cells. So it is 11 hours and it is 24 hours. If you see the mitosis, synthesis, S phase, G2 phase, it is almost similar. But G1 phase, it has 11 hours here, it is 1 hour. And if you observe all the cells, it is that G1 which varies. Rest all, it's almost the same time. So this is showing the different phases. G2M phase, most sensitive. G then followed by G1, then early S phase, late S phase. So S phase is the most resistant. Reason for differential radiosensitivity: late S phase presence of a sister chromatid favors homologous recombination repair. G2M phase, no time for repair. Cells proceed to mitosis and encounters mitotic catastrophe. Okay. So during S phase, there is prompt repair, and that is the reason S phase is more sensitive. G2M phase, there is no repair, and that is the reason it is more sensitive. Okay. And another thing is oxygen effect over cell cycle. Oxygen OER varies significantly. So with the class, when we take what do you mean sulfhydryl groups? See, the major means, as in you're saying, their impact upon repair about the sulfhydryl groups. See, I don't think they have much, they have a greater impact. Okay, so what about sulfhydryl and the role of radio resistance? It is related to the repair, means, see, sulfhydryl groups, they are present, they bind to the radicals, and that is one way they are preventing the damage. And the second, sulfhydryl groups, they are also involved into the repair mechanisms. I guess this is what you asked, because I have not understood your question. I'm sorry. In S phase, the basic principle to remember why it is more resistant, because DNA multiplication is happening and the DNA repair is at its peak. So all the players who are involved in DNA repair will be actively involved. Okay. So that's why there will be maximum radio resistance. Now, OER, we'll be learning about this in detail when we'll be doing the topic LET, RBE, and OER. OER varies significantly through the cell cycle. For G2 phase, the OER is 2.3 to 2.4. For S phase, it is 2.8 to 2.9. G1 is intermediate values. OER appears to be larger, higher doses, lower levels of survival. Probably most number of cells are in S phase. जनरल कंक्लूजन, सेल्स आर मोस्ट सेंसिटिव एट और क्लोज टू एम, मोस्ट रेजिस्टेंट ड्यूरिंग लेट एस, मोस्ट सेंसिटिव टू हाइपोथर्मिया इन फॉर एस फेज, मोस्ट सेंसिटिव टू ऑक्सीजन जीवन फेज, फॉर प्रोलॉन्ग जीवन अर्ली पीरियड और रेजिस्टेंट पीरियड इज एविडेंट फॉलोड बाई सेंसिटिव फेज, सेल्स आर यूजली सेंसिटिव टू रेडिएशन ड्यूरिंग जी टू फेज. ऑर्डर ऑफ रेडियो सेंसिटिविटी जी टू एम लेट जीवन अर्ली एस लेट एस. ओके विल एंड हियर टूडे. We'll end the session. We'll restart tomorrow on from reoxygenation and finish off. Okay. Any doubts? So quickly brush it up. We studied about repair, repopulation, and redistribution. Any doubts? Another thing, how many of you actually did that exercise which I told about the dose conversions, the EQD2 and that overall treatment time and reactions? Am I audible? Okay, I guess no issues. So see you tomorrow. Bye, guys.